The NES was the second home console I had growing up, and it definitely changed things for the better in my opinion. I mean, coming off of the video game crash of 83, the NES brought better quality games and changed the perception of what the market could be like for gamers at that time. They took steps to avoid being associated with the gaming market of just a few short years prior to the launch of the NES, but it wasn't all rainbows and unicorns. While I think Nintendo did a lot of great things, they also tried to monopolize the video game marketplace with their kind of ridiculous tactics and policies. Some may argue that was kind of for the better at the time, so we wouldn't have another crash. But hey, either way you want to look at it, there is no denying the impact the NES had on the world. Its influence is definitely present today. A lot of popular franchises got started on the NES. So many games that, in my opinion, even though they are well over 30 years old, still hold up to today. Sure, there are some stinkers on the NES, but the library was full of awesomeness as well. Now, I know a lot of people who watch my channel are into retro games, and every day it seems like more and more people want to revisit their past gaming experiences. So that's why I cover so many different options on my channel. But just a reminder, which really shouldn't even have to be said, but you'll always have some people either gatekeeping or trying to put others down on how they decide to enjoy the hobby. Now, with retro games, I've always said this, there are no right or wrong answers, just preferences. If you find an option that fits your budget and you enjoy it, who gives a shit what anyone has to say about it? And that includes me. You don't have to care about every option I discuss. I just want people to be aware of what's available. So one popular option for people wanting to play NES games on original or clone hardware has been multi-carts. They've existed for many years, including going back to when the NES was still on the market. Multi-carts have varied in quality and content. Some have a small selection of games, maybe just focusing on one franchise like Mega Man. Some think quantity is king and will throw at you like 500 or more games. And sure, having nearly the entire NES library on one cart is kind of a cool idea, but a lot of times those carts are full of bootlegs and crappy hacks and even duplicates of the same games over and over just with name changes. Now, the cart I want to discuss today, I found a while back and ordered it for around 20 bucks. I haven't paid much attention to these types of carts for a while, as I typically use an EverDrive N8 Pro, but I wanted to have an extra NES setup with its own cart and couldn't see spending $200 or more for a flash cart again. So I wanted to see if this $239-in-1 cart was worth a damn and share my findings with you guys. I mean, it was only 20 bucks. Now, what drew me to this cart was the game list and the promise of no battery saves that last forever. So there are quite a few games on this cart that normally would have battery saves. Now, I remember other multi-carts I'd seen before that could only support saving one game at a time. If you saved another game on the cart, your save for the other game would be wiped. Kinda lame. But this one doesn't work that way. It appears to have built-in memory that is capable of holding saves for all the games without having to worry about losing them. For the about a month I've had this thing, I have saves on quite a few games and they are all still there and load up just fine. Nothing has happened, so that's a huge plus. Now, the game list here is only 239 games, which is still quite a bit. And it's actually about a third of the complete licensed US library. But my worry was, would this be full of ROM hacks and junk or misnamed garbage? Now, out of the 239 games here, only 5 of them were bootlegs or ROM hacks. These are kind of interesting though. You get weird games like Mortal Kombat 2, which really would have been interesting if it actually officially released on the NES back in the day. But this bootleg is actually an unlicensed port of the first Mortal Kombat and not actually Mortal Kombat 2. Not sure why they named it that way. I mean, bootleggers be trying to do whatever it takes, I guess, to entice people to buy their products. But in all honesty, this game isn't exactly horrible. It plays decently well. It does take some liberties with the moveset, so it's not exactly a faithful port regardless. I mean, we also get a Street Fighter 2 port here that I found kind of interesting, as I have played this before. On here, it's called Master Street 2, which I tried playing it on several consoles through this multi-cart, and it always glitches out after I select my character and start the match. This is the one thing I wanted to touch on here. I think for the money, this is a fantastic collection of games. It's mostly all the heavy hitters and classics you would want to play, but after having tested pretty much everything on it, I did find a few issues. Overall, not the most horrible of issues. I mean, these weird ROM hack bootleg games, they're mostly what I had issues with, actually having the games function anyway. Now, another issue with these ROM hacks was Disney's Aladdin, which is a hack game that winds up crashing at certain points. And the other hacks, which were Lion King 6 and Deadpool, which is a hack of Ninja Gaiden, I didn't have any issues with. So there's that. Now, there are a few other non-originally released in the US games on the list, but they appear to be mostly translations of games like Final Fantasy II, Adventure Island 4. You also have a prototype game that wasn't released, RoboCop vs. Terminator, which presents another issue. So I had to search through this whole cartridge to make sure there wasn't any other problems. And I really didn't find any, but it was just this one. There are three games on the list with RoboCop in the title, but somehow they messed it up. Not the biggest deal, but RoboCop 1 and RoboCop vs. Terminator are swapped with each other's titles when selecting a game from the main menu. Now, I really like how clean this multi-cart is presented. The first 30 games on the list, though, are from the NES Classic Edition, which is kind of cool, I guess, but I think it would have been better to put them in with the rest of the games, so everything stayed alphabetical order. But that is the good thing here. After those first 30 games, everything's in alphabetical order and is easily identifiable what the game is. Other carts I've messed with, I mean, it seemed like everything was fairly random and it was hard to identify what the games were, so very clean here. And you can also go to the little letter index on the cart and move through the list to whatever letter you choose. Very convenient. Now, the cart's also supposed to be region-free for PAL or NTSC. So if you boot it up on an NTSC system, it'll show that in the menu. If you boot it up in a PAL system, it'll also show that in the menu. I find that interesting that the cart's able to match it up, change the region, and show that in the menu. Kind of cool. So out of those issues that I mentioned a moment ago, which don't really bother me too much, I think, the only other problem I found was Super Mario Bros. 3. Now, this is an interesting one that I cannot figure out why it is doing it. But when you play the game through this multi-cart on an original NES or a higher-end clone system like the Retro USB AVS, it plays perfectly fine. But on cheaper clones like the Retrobit Super Retro Trio Plus and the Classic 3 HD that I recently reviewed, the game has speckles all over the screen during the entire time playing it. On the cart, this was the only game I found that behaved this way, and I tried playing it, switching the region from NTSC to PAL on these clone consoles, and no matter, it still happened on the cheap clones. So this may affect you, or it may not, but it was the biggest problem I found here, and I had to point that out. It's just one game, but yeah, it's kind of annoying. So out of the 239 games, they are mostly awesome classics that you'll want to play. There will be a few notable games missing here, like Castlevania 3, but still not a bad list. So real quick, before we wrap this video up, I picked 5 games from this list that I think are must-plays. So in no particular order, check these games out. First one, Journey to Silius. This one is an awesome-looking run-and-gun game that was originally supposed to be based on the Terminator movie, but due to licensing issues, that was scrapped and we got this game instead. It's kind of a shame because licensed games at that time got such a bad rap, and this is one of the finest action games on the NES and could have gone down as, hey, at least the Terminator game was a good movie game, right? Didn't have too many. Next is the Cryon Conquest. Now, I never really knew about this game before, but I believe a subscriber to my channel, Papstoben, brought it up during a live stream a long while back. And I think I gave it a chance at the time, but I may have slightly dismissed it as it seemed like a straight-up Mega Man clone. And yes, it is heavily influenced by Mega Man to the point of being really close to infringing on it, but it plays fantastically well and has enough changes to the gameplay and mechanics and level design that it's just a ton of fun to play. I mean, I've played through it a few times since. Highly recommend checking it out. Next up is one I'm sure a lot of people have heard of, But have you ever really gave it a chance, right? Little Samson for the NES. It's a notoriously expensive game if you want the original. It was a late release in the NES lifecycle, so not a lot of people probably were aware of it at the time, as they were moving on to the Super Nintendo. But it's a very polished platformer game that does have a few minor similarities to Mega Man, but also a ton of differences, different characters you play as, and you know, there's enough here that I think it's a really solid game worth playing through. Okay, so two more titles I want to mention real quick, and a couple of my all-time favorites on the NES. Jackie Chan Action Kung Fu. While I think the TurboGrafx version is better, this is still an amazing version. Huge sprites, colorful games, smooth gameplay, and Jackie Chan. It's awesome. What more do you need to know, right? Now finally, Snow Bros. I love this game, so yeah, I had to mention it. Arcade games at home during the time of the NES were awesome. Sure, they were mostly not perfect ports of the arcade games. Yeah, we had graphics and sound downgrades, but a lot of them were still really faithful to their counterparts. And this one, I loved it. I loved the arcade version. I loved it at home as well. If you haven't played Snow Bros, I mean, at least give it a shot. I talk about it all the time. But there you go. The classic collection of NES pixel games. I'm not even sure what to call this cart, but it's $239.01. Think it's a decent deal? Just wanted people to see another option out there. Let me know what you think down below. Really do appreciate you guys. Catch you on the next one. Bye.